anybody here does JavaScript? Okay, like there, maybe you can push that stone up for like 2 microseconds, and then the next framework is already there, and now you have to like push a different stone up the mountain. So anyway, this is our problem that we're facing. And I think fundamentally it's because we have the wrong mental model for programs. If you look at the memory model for imperative programming, that's edge labeled mutable graphs, right? So if you look at an object graph in memory, like if you use Java, JavaScript, whatever, these are graphs. They're edge labeled and they're mutable, so you can kind of like, you know, mutate them. And those are not, they don't have like, you know, really nice properties. So that's why everybody's trying to get, like, think about immutability and functional programming and whatever. But even there, if you look at functional programming, we kind of pretend that we're dealing with functions, but really these are procedures that have still have side effects, right? They're still exceptions, they're still concurrency. So whatever we try, we really always get, like, you know, fall short of that ideal abstraction that we really want, because the reality of the fact that a computer is a physical thing is always dragging that stone down. I don't know anybody here, you know, you try to write your code in a very abstract way, and then you look at the performance, it sucks, right? Now you have to kind of like manually kind of like, you know, care about the garbage collector and so on. And soon you're programming in Rust or C++ again, because that's where you can control all these side effects. And I think the real problem behind this all is that everything we do is ultimately boils down to the von Neumann machine. Every computer that we use these days is based on this principle. And really the only thing a von Neumann machine can do, if you can boil it down to the very essence, is it can move something from one address in memory to another address in memory. If you Google for single instruction machine, you will find, like, you know, a paper where they got, like, you know, actually built such a machine. But again, think of it conceptually, right? Everything you do is moving things from one memory location to the other. Maybe some memory locations are called registers. Maybe when you move it from one place to the other, you can do some operation on it, like addition or something. But ultimately, the only thing that our computers can do, and they can do it really fast, is moving stuff from one place to the other. And then on top of that, we're trying to hide that to kind of like build some grand abstraction that we want to do. So we have layer after layer after layer, but just like in the fairy tale of the princess and the pea, you can always feel the fucking pea, right? It's always there. You can't just not hide it. Programming is not a fairy tale. So how can we make programming into a fairy tale? That's the kind of like, you know, the question. So let's look at different style of programming. Relational databases. So relational databases leverage very clever mathematics, relational algebra. They are relatively easy to reason about, and moreover, they're easy to optimize. And if you look at the query languages for relational databases, they are declarative and pure, right? So this is like, you know, enormous success. It's a very simple model. It's not some artificial thing that's kind of like based on moving things around and mutation, no. It's tables with well-defined operations that have a strict mathematical basis, and that allows us to kind of do crazy query optimization. But again, we kind of run into this abstraction boundary because our programs are written in Java, JavaScript, C++, whatever, where we have these mutable edge-labeled graphs. The database consists of tables, and now we have what's called the impedance mismatch. And you have to get, like, now bridge that gap. For a while I worked on that. It looked that SQL was going to die when everybody was talking about NoSQL. I tried to phrase that as co-SQL, but now everybody is new SQL and SQL has won. And the reason is that SQL is just founded in a very beautiful and simple mathematical theory, and you cannot kind of kill math. Math will always survive. And our current programming languages and our machines that are based on moving things around don't have a nice mathematical basis. So I think they will have they're also hard to kill, but I think it's much harder to get, like, you know, to optimize. All right. Now, some people say that today, in today's world, we are kind of like in the software 1.0 world. And what is a little bit sad is that the world today is very much kind of like plagued by a lot of diversity that is not really diverse. I already kind of made some jokes about the JavaScript frameworks. And at a certain level of abstraction, all these JavaScript frameworks are more or less the same. Yet, we make a big deal out of it. Look, no, today I need to use Vue.js. No, it's React. Whatever. Why don't we focus on what's common instead of what is different? And why are we keep wasting our time kind of like learning new things for kind of like small gains? But the same thing is true about programming languages. If you look at, say, programming languages for mobile, there's Swift, Objective-C, Java, Kotlin, C#, you name it. But if you look at these languages from a little bit of a distance, they are more similar than different. And so why are we wasting our time, you know, fighting over small change instead of really solving the problem? And the same thing, you see the same trend on the server side where, you know, there's an explosion of programming languages. And it's kind of strange that, like, you know, there's so many new programming languages, but they're not really new. I don't think they really solve the problem of making programming easier. Now, look at what people call software 2.0. So software 2.0, Andre here says, is that in this case, you don't write code, but you train your code. If you have a lot of data, you can use that to get, like, you know, generate your code. That to me sounds like a much better way to write code. We have so much data these days, everything generates data. So instead of writing code by hand, instead of doing test-driven development where, you know, as a human, I give you some tests and you write the code, why can't I take those tests, give it to a machine, and let that machine kind of like create the program? And I don't even care how that program looks like, because if it works, it works. I mean, my code is not readable, so why should this thing that this machine generates be readable? Now, here's an interesting way to look at that, right? So I said, like, what I want to do is I want to have, like, a magical device that I can give data, and it gives me back code. Now, think about that. That is the dual of a magical device that we just discussed, which is the database, the relational database. That is something that I give code or a query, and it gives me back data. And if you get, like, you know, I have seen some of my talks, I always talk about duality. And this is a very fascinating duality, right? So we know how to do this. And the question is, can we do this? So can we build a machine where we just pump in data and on the other side, out comes code? And then we can all go to Foo Cafe all day long. And we can listen to other talks about, I don't know, water skiing, fishing, I don't know, painting, making tie-dyes, because the machines will write the software for us. Isn't that a great future? That's the future that I want to create. Yep. All right, is this better? All right. So the old way to create code is we have a human. The human takes coffee or beer and translates into code. And the new way, so this is the first one, is software 1.0. And software 2.0 is where we have a machine, we give it a lot of data, and out comes code. And just like in the SQL case, we don't call it code, we call it a query. In this case, we don't call it code, but we call it a model, but really it's just code. There's one fundamental difference between code and models. Code is deterministic and discrete. If you have a Boolean, that Boolean is true or false. But if you use a spam filter, that's one of those things that is learned by a machine learning algorithm, it doesn't give you true or false. It gives you like, you know, this message is spam with probability 0.9, and it's not spam with probability 0.1. All right? So it's very different. It's uncertain. And often, also, when you're dealing with probability distributions, they are continuous. So it's not like a discrete set of values, but it can be like any value from like, you know, a wide range. And that is the kind of price that we have to pay to get moved from the old world, from kind of like code for programming 1.0 to the world of programming 2.0. And as developers, we're often a little bit afraid of dealing with uncertainty, right? It's like, I want this thing to be really true or false. But you know, now it's kind of like, you know, sometimes true, sometimes false, depending on whatever. Well, in some sense, we're already used to this uncertainty. If you look at floating point numbers, they are not really real numbers, right? Not the real numbers that you know from mathematics. They're already an approximation. And so a lot of it, like all our airplanes and everything, is based on these floating point numbers that are approximations of real numbers. So I think we can handle that. Now, if we move to this world on the right, the world of programming 2.0, then we get some really nice mathematics. We get some really old-fashioned mathematics from the 18th century or even from the 17th century that is as kind of like beautiful as the mathematics that relational algebra is built on. And as I said, you can never kind of like beat mathematics. So hopefully this will give us a kind of like an even better basis for, you know, building our programming abstractions. So this is what we want to do. We want to kind of like, you know, lever ancient and clever mathematical tricks to kind of like, you know, to come up with a function. And how do we get that function? Well, we give it examples of input-output pairs, just like when you do test-driven development. Then we look at the answer that this machine gives us, and that differs from the gap, like, you know, from the answer that we kind of like expect. And what we're trying to do is we're trying to minimize the error. With humans, if you kind of like your program doesn't compute the kind of like expected results, you get fired or whatever. Here, we're trying to kind of like, you know, minimize the error by making this function better. So let's look at a very simple form of machine learning, linear regression, that everybody of you probably did in elementary school or high school when you were doing physics. You know, you were doing some physics experiments, so you made some measurements, and then you had to kind of fit a line through all your points. All right, so this is the kind of our tasks. This is our kind of like, you know, our magic device. We give it a whole bunch of these points, and since we need to get like, you know, guess this this line, it needs to tell us A and B, and then our program is done. Okay, so some people kind of say it's like machine learning is just curve fitting, and I think that's just fine. Only these curves can also become very complicated. They can be so complicated that I would even challenge you that you can generate functions like this that you could never, even if I would pay you a million Swedish kroner, that's not that much, right? 10 million Swedish kroner, you couldn't write it, right? Look at your cell phone, you know, and when it sees a face, it puts a box around the face. I bet that nobody could write that program from scratch without learning it. All right, so that already shows that using machine learning, you can write much more powerful algorithms than what you could do in the programming 1.0 way. All right, so how does this work? Well, first of all, you know, to make this work and to generalize this a little bit, you can deal only with functions that take arrays or vectors or tensors, whatever fancy names people give to them, of real numbers. All right, so there we already have a little bit of an abstraction barrier, because again, the imperative programs that we write use graphs, and here we suddenly have, like, you know, vectors of real numbers, and they get, like, you know, vectors of real numbers. Now the functions that you write can be a composition of other functions as long as they're differentiable. I'll talk about that is. And then what we're doing is we're trying to get, like, you know, minimize the error. So the error between the expected value and the computed value. And you can get, like, you know, this is the kind of square of the absolute value, whatever. You can come up with some kind of measure of how different these things are. But just to know, just like with relational databases, where we had, like, a beautiful mathematical theory that didn't really match with our current way of programming, the same is happening here. All right, so given this set of training data, we have to find these points. And the way you do that is by taking the derivatives of this function, the derivatives with respect to A and B. I'll talk a little bit more about that later. And then you just kind of run through the training set, and then you kind of, like, you know, you update the A and Bs that you get. And you do that, kind of, like, you know, long enough. So you update that with some multiplication of the, kind of, like, you know, the derivative and some constant. You just repeat that a lot of times, and then out comes A and B that, kind of, like, you know, fits that line. Now this is beautiful. This is still imperative because you're actually updating weights, but the imperativeness is done during training. And once you have these A and B, you really get a pure function back. And that's a function that you can compute with later. Now, I skipped over these derivatives. Now, probably you remember from high school when you had to find, like, the minimum of a function. You know, I don't know. When, you know, you throw a ball, when is the ball has speed zero or something like that. You do that using derivatives, and you can see here's a mathematical definition of the derivative where this epsilon goes to zero, blah, 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 blah. And then you learned how to kind of take the derivative of a function. So in this case, if I have the function y equals 3x squared plus 4, then you kind of can take the derivative, so that becomes 6x plus 0. You all remember that a little bit? And then you think, like, but did you ever really understand how it worked? You kind of just applied these rules, right? You just kind of, like, knew how to do this. Well, let me give you some magic how we can compute these things automatically. All right, and again, how do we do that? We use some more math. And to do that, we use this thing called dual numbers. So you maybe remember, again, from high school, you remember what a complex number was, right? A complex number was a pair of numbers, a plus b times I. And then this was like a weird, kind of, like, you know, the I was kind of like a weird thing because, like, you know, I squared equals minus one. Everybody remembers that? And they were called complex numbers because that's kind of complex, right? It's like, and mind-blowing, how can you get, like, something squared be minus one? But hey, you know, we cannot make up our rules. And turns out that complex numbers are very useful in many mathematical domains. If you do, kind of, like, electronics or physics or whatever. Now let's do another trick. Let's take these complex numbers, and instead of, and then to just distinguish them, instead of I write here epsilon, because I used epsilon here to when I defined the derivative. And now, just for fun, I will say, why don't we make epsilon square be zero? Right, why is it minus one? Let's just make it zero, and then try to see what it does. You can say, hey, What about if I can define another one, say with j, and define j squared equals 1? Because like the only reasonable values are minus 1, 0, and 1, right? Those are the only like real values. Well, that's if you get Google hyperbolic numbers, you will find that they are also useful. But for now, I want to focus on these things that are dual numbers, okay? And this is one of those things where I would say, don't ask how it's possible, just profit from it, all right? Because let's compute this function f with this dual number, all right? So let's just kind of like, you know, our function was like, you know, 3x squared plus 4. Right, that was our function. Let's kind of make sure that it's the right function. Yep, 3x squared plus 4. And we call this function now with this number a plus b epsilon. So that's 3 times a plus b times epsilon squared plus 4. You know, a plus b squared is a squared plus 2ab plus b squared. We all remember that. Simple, like, you know, any person, all your kids or whatever could do this. We kind of just distribute the 3 over there. Now we're moving things around a little bit. And then we kind of recognize, if we move it around here, that this is 3 times a squared plus 4. So this is f of a. We knew what f prime was, the derivative. That was 6 times a, right? So this is f prime of a times b of epsilon, and then epsilon squared was 0, so this is 0. So magically, if I call this function, the same function I have, with this dual number, I compute both the value for the, like the real part, and the derivative for that second part. Isn't that magic? So you don't have to know anything about derivatives. You just implement these dual numbers and automatically you will get the derivative of a function. And you get those just by kind of like, you know, trying out. So let's take this kind of weird thing like complex numbers and just make I squared to be 0 instead of minus 1. Isn't that magic? I mean, I think it is, but it's pretty cool. So everybody can kind of like, you know, maybe not in Java because it's hard to kind of overload arithmetic operations in Java, but you can kind of like, you know, implement this pretty easily yourself. And so in that way, you get this automatic differentiation. So if you look at a lot of these deep learning frameworks, a lot of them use dual numbers to compute derivative. But again, don't ask how this is possible, just profit from it. And of course, you can, like, if I would have more time, I could get like explain how it works mathematically, but this is, I think, a thing of pure beauty. Another thing, maybe you can like remember the chain rule, how you take the derivative of the composition of two functions. I can never remember the chain rule. I always have to go to Wikipedia to get like, you know, remember the chain rule. But if I define this higher order function big T of f to be this kind of like, you know, to compute f plus the derivative, then I can show that this thing distributes over composition in a nice way. And then if it's the identity, it returns the identity. And that's much more, much nicer than the chain rule. All right, so this kind of like these dual numbers kind of like, you know, also have much better compositional properties than the kind of like the regular derivative. So this is the kind of like, you know, that magic machine that that I showed you. It is possible. So this is the dual of a SQL database. I have training data. The training data consists of pairs of input and output values. I feed this input into a composition of differentiable functions. And how do I compute the derivative of a function? Using these dual numbers, so I don't have to do anything. I don't have to get like do symbolic differentiation or whatever. I overload all the operators to work on these pairs of numbers instead of numbers themselves. Out comes a guess and the actual output value. And then based on the derivative, I kind of update these weights to kind of like, you know, make the output closer to the expected output. And I just rinse and repeat. And I rinse and repeat. Isn't that beautiful? This is like what I call, like, you know, this is how programming should be. Now, what is a neural network? Well, a neural network is just something where these functions in here, these functions in the model, have a certain shape. So they are kind of like, you know, some what people call activation functions, and they can multiply the inputs with the weights. And why is that useful? Well, some people think that it has to do something with, like, you know, neurons in your brain. I don't believe so. I think it's because if you have multiplication and additions, you can do that very efficiently on your graphics card. All right, and I don't think, well, we're visual animals, but I don't think we have graphics cards in our skulls. But, you know, picking these functions that require lots of additions and multiplications, we know how to do that efficiently, so it's kind of convenient. For me, I don't really believe in that kind of, like, you know, this the biological analogy, but that's fine. You can believe it. You can believe in, I don't know, what do they have here for Christmas? I don't know. Do they have Santa Claus here too? You can believe in it if you want to. What is differentiable programming? So differentiable programming is like deep learning, where except instead of, you know, just sticking to these very specific functions here, like of this activation function plus doing the product of the inputs and the weights, you can do kind of more arbitrary functions. And so that's the kind of, like, I think the future of programming is differentiable programming. So what you do is you stick together a bunch of these differentiable functions, you collect a lot of training data, and then you pump this through that kind of, like, you know, that magic machine learning thingy, and out comes a function that will do what you want. All right, so to define models, we use differentiable programming. And these differentiable programs are functional programs, because ultimately that function that you compute is a pure function. So everybody that's been trying for many years to get, like, promote functional programming, like Martin Oderski, right, with Scala, they were right, except that the future is not called Scala, but the future is called differentiable programming. But still, it's functional programming. And there's a lot of literature about it. So there's, like, you know, here are a couple of papers that you could read. I'll just kind of skip through them. But it's like, you know, there's many and many of them. And then at Facebook, we're kind of like doing this kind of differentiable programming as well, where we're kind of like, we're combining Caffe2 and PyTorch in something called PyTorch 1.0. But if you look at that, basically, that's a form of differentiable programming. All right. Now, one thing I forgot to say, or I didn't forget to say it, but these the functions that this machine learning algorithm creates are only approximations to a function, right? So they don't give you, like, a real function that got, like, you know, it might give you, it gives you something that returns a probability distribution. Now, the good news is that, as I said in the beginning, a normal function is also an approximation, right? If you think you have a function from A to B, it really is a function that has side effects. So I don't know, it's like, you know, for Haskell people or whoever people in the room here, it lives in the I/O monad. And so these models, for the same reason, live in the monad, they live in the probability monad. So you can never escape these kind of side effects. But it is fine. Now let's kind of like apply duality again. So the first time we applied duality was to say, look, we have a database, we can feed it code, it gives us data. Can we turn that around and can we build something that we give data and gives us code, right? And that worked wonderfully well. We needed a couple of tricks like differentiation, but we can fix differentiation using these dual numbers. And the way we did that is we tried to minimize the loss. So we tried to minimize the gap, like the the difference between the expected value and the the value that we computed. Now, if we try to minimize the loss, maybe we can do something different. We can try to maximize a probability, right? Making something smaller and making something bigger is also an example of duality. And since these things are handling probability distributions, let's try if this is possible. And also, this will give us some idea of monads. This is the probability monad. So probability monad is a probability distribution. And a probability distribution is, think of it as a little bit of a database, right? So this fancy P of A is like a database with values of type A, except that with each value in the database, it has like a weight, a probability. Okay, so if I take a dice, it's a database that has six numbers, and each of these numbers has equal probability. So each of these numbers has probability 1/6. Okay? Now, there you need to have a bind operation. So you have a probability distribution. Then the mathematicians write this weird thing, and they call it a conditional distribution. But this is really a function from A to probability of B. Mathematicians pronounce it as the probability of B given A, which is, for a computer scientist, exactly a function, right? Give me an A, and I give you a probability distribution of B. And then it will compute a probability distribution of B. So this is the probability monad. And now I can write a query. As I said, these probability distributions are like little databases. So I can now write something that looks like a SQL query, where I can get this value A from some guess, which is a distribution that gives me the values that A can range over. I guess B, where I pick it from some distribution where B can range over, and these are probably Gaussians. Then I define my function f in terms of A and B. Then I grab some error. That was the the red thing in the picture with the monkey. And then I filter for this thing here. I'm trying to filter where the error is minimal, and then I get this f. All right, so if you look at these probability distributions as small databases where each of the values are weights, then you can write queries over these databases with where clauses and everything. The mathematicians call this conditioning, and this is drawing from a distribution. If you Google Bayesian linear regression, you will find something like this. So this is the same thing as we did first with machine learning, but by updating the weights. We do this now by writing a query over probability distributions. And again, a probability distribution is nothing more than a tiny database or a big database if you have a continuous distribution where everything has weights. Now, I write this here in handwritten, so this doesn't execute. But there are things that are called probabilistic programming languages, and those are languages that have probability distributions built in. And one such a language is called WebPPL. And you see here that this is the same program. Instead of A and B, I use M and B. But it does the same thing. And if you run this program, it will tell you that what the in this case the value of M is. It's 8, but now you see that it gives you a probability distribution, because you have to put that line in all these points, so that's also a little bit uncertain. Right? So the future is, when we have these models that we get from machine learning, we compose them using probabilistic programming. So let's look at that into a little bit more detail, because maybe you think my head hurts. I need Michael, do you have something stronger than beer? Because there's all this probability distribution. Let's look at a very simple example. Let's build an animal predictor, okay? And this animal predictor is going to give a picture of an animal. It's an app that you snap a picture of an animal and it will tell you whether this animal is safe to pet. Okay? So, of course, if you have a crocodile, that's not safe to pet. And if you have whatever, that meat-eating plant, that's not safe to pet. But maybe, like, you know, a cow is safe to pet, and a pig, and a little chicklet, all right? So that's the app we're going to write. So first of all, we train a model, a deep net called convolutional neural net. And that thing will be a function that, given a picture, will tell us a probability of an animal, right? So if I give it a picture of a pig, it will say, oh, that is a pig with 0.8% probability and Eric Meyer with 0.2% probability, something like that. And so all for all these animals, right? It will kind of like make the best guess it can. Now let's kind of like, you know, have the second thing here, and that gives us a text, and it will say that you can pet the animal. So this is like, you know, another model that does natural language processing, and what it does is you give it a description of the animal, and this thing will tell you whether it can, you can pet it or not. And think of this as like a spam filter, right? A spam filter takes your email, which is a piece of text, and it tells you it's spam or not spam. So I can train the same model here where I give it a text and it will tell me whether this animal is pettable or not. And just like in spam, when it looks for kind of spam words, this thing will look for pet words like bites, poison. Those are all like non-pettable things. And fluffy and cute are all the kind of pettable words, right? So can you, you can imagine that you can build this model just like a spam filter, all right? And then the third thing is I have a description of an animal, and now I need, or like I have the name of an animal that I got from this picture recognizer. I have this thing that can analyze text, but now I need to get like take the description of an animal and get the description of that animal. And for that, we can use Wikipedia, all right? Now, of course, if I can make a web service call to Wikipedia, that can take a long time. So this thing will not return a probability distribution, but it will return a future, right? Or a task or whatever to express that this thing is slow. So now let's kind of like, you know, build our app. I want to kind of like take the image recognizer and take the animal that gets predicted. I want to pass that to Wikipedia as a query, and then I want to get the text. And given that text, I want to predict whether that the animal described in this text can be pet, can be petted, right? So that should be the kind of way that I kind of compose this app using these three components. Unfortunately, I cannot just kind of like, you know, that's why you see here these lines are red. I get a probability distribution of an animal, like pig, 80%, Eric Meyer, 20%. And the Wikipedia article needs an animal. So I cannot, it doesn't fit, right? And the same thing, I get a future of a text, but this kind of like, you know, natural language thing kind of expects a text. So it doesn't work. So what probabilistic programming does, it allows you to get like, you know, still compose these things. And just like in JavaScript, where you can await a future, here you can sample from a distribution. So I kind of call this convolutional neural net with the kind of picture. I get a probability distribution, and now I can sample from that to get an animal. And I take the animal, I pass it in the Wikipedia service call. I get a future, I await the future, I get text, I push it in there, and so on. So what this thing returns is a future of a probability distribution of something I can pet. All right, so it's just kind of like composition of these effects. And people here know JavaScript or C# async await? Yeah, so this is the same as async await, except you sample from a distribution. And then under the covers, the JavaScript thing uses .then. The probability distribution uses that kind of like, you know, that star that takes a distribution and a conditional distribution. Nothing different. Here's another example to kind of show you that these probability distributions are like little databases. Say that I have a set of playing cards, okay, 52 cards. Now I can ask a query. So what is the probability? And then I put a predicate in here, the probability that the rank of the card is a queen. Well, there's four queens, right? And so the probability is there's 54 cards, sorry. So the probability is 4 out of 54. Now I can ask, what is the probability that it's a heart, given that the rank of the card is a queen? Well, that's 1 divided by 4, because there's only one a queen of hearts. And now I can compute, what is the probability that the card is a queen and a heart? And that's different than this, because that's like, you know, this is, I know that it's a queen. Then what is the probability that it's a heart? And in this case, it is, what is the probability that it's a queen and a heart? Which is like, you know, I multiply these probabilities, and guess what? It's like 1 over 54. Right? So it's a database with a simple query language. And what that query language does is it multiplies all these probabilities. Now you think that looks kind of pretty fancy, right? It's like, you know, but it's not that fancy. And in fact, this guy, Bayes, invented this thing in 1763. So I think that most of us were not born yet at that time, but this guy already kind of like, you know, invented this thing where, you know, you multiply a probability with a conditional probability. That's the same as the kind of joint probability and the opposite. So this is like the theorem, Bayes' theorem, underlies probabilistic programming. So, as I said, we build models using machine learning. So we give it data, we pump data in it, and out we get this model. And what is a model? That's a function that returns a probability distribution. Now, if we have a number of these models, and we need to combine them into an app, like the simple app that I showed you, we use probabilistic programming. So the future of programming is combining neural nets with probabilistic programming. So here you are. This is the future of programming, and the singularity will be near. What that means is that now the computer can train itself and get better and better. And at some point, we as humans will, like, you know, we can go to Food Cafe every day and kind of like, you know, enjoy talks on art or music or whatever, while the machines kind of like, you know, do the programming for us. And I hope that, you know, it doesn't bite itself accidentally and kills itself. All right, thank you so much. And welcome to the world of programming 2.0.